Thank you for joining us today for this important conversation. We're delighted that you could be with us. Not only do we have students and some faculty colleagues here, but we have alums and pastors from the area, and we're just so pleased to see all of you. We're looking forward to the conversation, to the two presentations, and then the opportunity to participate together in a discussion in a few minutes at the end. So I think you'll find this to be an energizing time for us. You'll find it to be informative, and we trust that it will be edifying and helpful for you. So thank you so much for coming. I want to thank Professor David Gustafson for his leadership in coordinating this and putting it together. We are thankful for him, the leadership he provides for our work in the area of evangelism and missions, and particularly the other faculty members in that department who have joined us this afternoon as well. The topic for today is the state of evangelicalism and the place of evangelism, or the state of evangelism as it impacts that. And you'll hear that unpacked from two different perspectives today by our speakers, who are both affiliate faculty members here at Trinity. And we count it a great joy and privilege to have both of them associated with this institution. Dr. Rick Richardson is a Trinity grad and holds a PhD from this place. He also has a seminary degree from Northern Baptist Seminary. He spent many years working with InterVarsity. He currently is on the faculty at Wheaton and directs their MA program in leadership and evangelism. He's a prolific author, and we look forward to hearing from him. And Dr. Ed Stetzer, also an affiliate faculty member here at Trinity. Dr. Stetzer serves as the executive director of Lifeway Research. He also is involved at Wheaton in the work of the Billy Graham Center. He speaks widely across the country on issues of church planting and cultural engagement and evangelism, and so this is right up his alley. Dr. Stetzer holds a PhD from the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky, and a Doctor of Ministry degree from Beeson Divinity School, and we are blessed to have both of these gentlemen with us this afternoon, and we'll look forward to learning from them as we listen to them. So as we begin, join me as we pray together and ask God's blessings upon our time. Oh God, how grateful we are for the privilege to gather this afternoon to hear these two that you have prepared so well address the important issues related to the gospel, the sharing of the gospel, the doing of evangelism, the extension of the work of the church in this country and around the world. And as we think about these important things, we pray that they not only would be informative for us, but they would be helpful in our service here on the Trinity campus, our service in churches, and in the places where you have placed each and every one of us. So we ask now your blessings upon this time. We ask that it would honor you and the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. We're glad you're here. Join me, please, in welcoming Dr. Ed Stetzer as he comes to speak.
Well, that is a gracious introduction. The reason I have those degrees that he mentioned is that 26 years ago, I was finishing up an MDiv. I had violated policy after policy after policy because I was in Buffalo, New York at the time. And taking classes at Christ the King Catholic Seminary. I studied Reformation history from the Catholic perspective. They're not a fan. I went to a seminary in Toronto. I went to a Colgate-Rochester Divinity School. Anyway, so finally I brought all these credits and the credits I was taking at the extension to the provost, and I said to the provost, can you please make an exception to residency so that I can graduate with my MDiv? And that provost, by the name of David Dockery, approved that exception 25, 26 years ago. So I want you to remember that if you ever need anything for an exception, just go to Dr. Dockery directly, bypass the deans, just jump right in and do that. Thank you. It's always good to see you and good to be here. Let me begin by giving you some stats. Let me just tell you, this is first and foremost what you need to know. Couple of things. First, We do a lot of research globally in Lifeway Research, but I'm going to focus here on the U.S. context. And the reason is because the situation is very different around the world. We're right now undertaking two projects in Brazil. And I would give you a very different answer if I was in Brazil than a project we're about to launch in the Philippines, for example. So there's different places where the church is experiencing different things. So here, I want to give you kind of an overarching view of where we are by starting with this slide. This is probably what you need to hear. The church in America is dying is the popular perception, but no real researcher anywhere actually believes that. And yet the reality is there's a whole evangelical publishing complex that is publishing these ideas and talking about these things. And as a matter of fact, right now on the Drudge Report, if you go to the Drudge Report, there's a link that talks about how Christianity is dying. If you click on it, it goes to a story from Vocative. In that story from Vocative, it says the percentage of people who believe in God has declined by 50%, and the percentage of people who pray is one-fifth of what it was. The problem is that's, and then you read the story says nothing like that, but the problem is there's this narrative out there that's easily produced and then reproduced that Christianity is actually dying. Now you could say, Ed, well, don't you have an incentive to say that Christianity is not dying because you work, for example, at a company that sells to Christians, which I do. I work at Lifeway. I lead Lifeway Research, but actually quite the contrary. If I actually wrote books that exaggerated the problem, told you Christianity was dying or in collapse, you would actually know who I was because you would have bought my books. Otherwise, Dr. had to introduce me because you don't, because my books don't sell millions of copies because I don't make up the statistics. Now, here's the deal. When it comes to real research, math is hard, but it's worth doing. And the reality is there's not a single researcher anywhere who believes that Christianity in America is dying. Say, Ed, how do you know? Have you talked to every real researcher? Well, pretty much. We talked to Robert Wuthnow at Princeton, Christian Smith at Notre Dame, Byron Johnson and Stark at Baylor, and anywhere you go, Frank Newport at Gallup, you talk to anywhere, what you find is, or Greg Smith at Pew, you find that Christians love bad statistics that actually show how badly they're doing. It led to an article in Books and Culture. The article in Books and Culture was written by Christian Smith at Notre Dame, and the title of the article was Evangelicals Behaving Badly with Statistics. And this is a common and recurring problem. We love bad statistics. Let me give you some example of the bad statistics that we love. For example, maybe you've heard or read or written that Christians and non-Christians divorce at the same rate. Well, that's true if you compare everyone who says they're a Christian, which is between 70 to 75% of the U.S. population, between everyone who says they're not a Christian, which is between 25 and 30% of the population. Those people divorce at about the same rate. But the problem is when you're a pastor or church leader and you say that in your church, what your people hear is the people in this room divorce at the same rate as the people outside, and that statistically is nowhere close to reality. Matter of fact, we look at the general social survey, what we find is that believers who show up every week actually are much less likely to divorce, not just among evangelicals, but among all religious traditions. Maybe you've heard that the next generation is all dropping out. There was a web page of a prominent youth ministry, and on that web page it said that that Christianity won't survive another decade unless we do something now. That webpage was, you'd know the name of the youth pastor if I said, it's a very prominent youth pastor leader. And I was fascinated by this concept. And by the way, he had something to do. The thing that to do now was to come to his amazing seminar. But here's the challenge is that, I mean, does anybody really believe that in 2026, the last Christian is going to walk out of Deerfield, Illinois, Evangelical Free Church, and join a Wiccan coven in Bannockburn, and then we're done with all Christians? I mean, that's ultimately what we're saying, that the next generation, so what do the actual statistics tell us? Well, when we look, here's a study we did. This is the only study I'll cite of my own, because I don't want you to say, well, Ed's just got his own research. No, I'm just telling you the consensus of the research, but here's a study we did. 70% of Protestants who attend high school regularly, at least 1 year in high school, excuse me, attend church regularly, at least 1 year in high school, will drop out for at least 1 year between the ages of 18 to 22. Now, maybe you've heard a different statistic. Just out of interest, how many of you have heard this statistic? 86% of evangelical youth drop out of church after high school, never to return. Have you heard that statistic? I mean, hands all over the room. Probably half of you heard that statistic. Well, I can tell you where that statistic came from. I can tell you Dr. Dockery and I know the person, a friend, and they had a meeting of youth pastors in Florida, they love Jesus, these youth pastors, and they got together, and because they love the Lord, and that's always the motivation, don't misunderstand, they all got together and said, what percentage do you think drop out, and what percentage do you think drop out, and what percentage do you think drop out? And then they averaged the guesses and released it as a research project. It was published in a denominational publishing house's news service. By the way, that denominational news service has since retracted the story. The people who put out the data have retracted the data. However, it won't die. Now, here's the deal. You can know right away that's a fake stat. Here's how you can know. There's one word in there. I'm going to say the stat. There's one word in there. When I get to that word, just say that word, and you'll be able to know why it's a fake stat. 86% of evangelical youth drop out of church after high school never to return. What's the word? Never. How does anybody know never? I mean, have we inserted tracking chips in the neck of American teenagers? And are we tracking them around for 30, 40 years? So anytime you hear a stat, you know, 80% of pastors drop out of the ministry, never to return. It's a fake stat. Anytime you hear someone, so-and-so leaves the church, never to return. It's a fake stat. Now, this stat is actually one that lines up similar with what Fuller Institute has done or some research that Pew has done, is that about 70% of Protestants who regularly attend at least 1 year drop out for at least 1 year between 18 and 22. But that doesn't mean they're necessarily Christians. Now, we define Christian differently in evangelical circles, right? So it doesn't mean they're necessarily had a born-again, life-changing experience. Doesn't mean they're evangelicals. They're not evangelicals. I mean, some are, but not as a whole. Doesn't even mean they're committed. So in other words, right now, in our student ministry at our church, we have a young kid who just started coming, friend of my daughter. She invited them. He's been coming now for maybe 3 or 4 months. If he drops out now and never comes back, not that we can count never, but if he never comes back, he would be counted in this number. But what people hear is that all of the teenagers in our churches are dropping out, and that's just not statistical reality. The next generation, well, it's hard to tell, right? I don't have a crystal ball, neither do you, but we do have some statistical measures of the next generation when we survey college students. So let me show you a recent survey by the American Religious Identification Survey, that's ARIS, among college students. Here's some numbers, right? These are among all college students in the United States. 32% of college students say they're religious, believe in God, attend services regularly. You say, Ed, that's a stunningly high number, okay? Well, you say, I go to the University of Chicago and I don't see that. I go to the University of Illinois and I don't see that. How can this be so? Here's why. Because a lot of those students are at Trinity and a lot of those students are at Wheaton or at Liberty or at Bethel. So what happens is that our secular universities are more secular, but university students as a whole, actually about 32% are religious by the standards of the ARIS. About a third are spiritual but not religious. 28% themselves secular or indifferent to religion. Now don't miss this. This is not a good news story. I don't want you to come out of here saying, well, Ed's saying everything's fine. I'm not. The fact that now 28% of the next generation considers itself secular, when you go back to prior generation, that's a doubling and a tripling. So though the church is not collapsing, secularism is taking hold. Let's use another example, right? Because America remains a remarkably devout nation. 40% claim they go to church weekly. You say, Ed, you don't believe 40% of people go to church weekly? Of course I don't. Okay, people answer polls, and we have a technical term to describe that they answer in ways they consider socially desirable. The technical term for that is lying. I survey pastors all the time. I'm well aware of the desire to exaggerate. So you say, well, how do you put this up here? Because here's the thing. We've been asking this question in research since the 1940s, right? So people have always exaggerated. You say, what exactly is it, 20%? Well, nobody really knows. There's one study done by Kirk Hathaway and Penny Marler of a few counties in Ohio that used time diary studies. And I'm happy to find that out. If any of you have a few million-dollar grant, we can do time diary studies and actually see where people go. But about 40% say they go weekly. That's higher than Italy, Britain, France, Russia. And Americans are more religious by attending religious services than Iranians. Matter of fact, the folks at Baylor, Rodney Stark and Byron Johnson, they're convinced that we're actually in a high of church attendance and involvement. More than 136 million Americans, 44% of the population, say they belong to a specific congregation. And I don't want you to miss this. Congregations remain relatively steady. Attendance has remained relatively steady recently. So where do we get these bad stats? We get them from people who love Jesus that want to help the church. We get them from a group of youth pastors who say, man, we got to fix youth ministry. A lot of it's really bad. And a lot of it is really bad. right? We got to fix that, right? Too many youth ministries are four-year holding tanks with pizza. We can't have that to be a real, genuine student ministry. So we get stats like this to motivate people to action, to motivate people for better marriages. The problem is sometimes I think they actually demotivate people. I don't want my daughter, as she goes off to college, my daughter is going to college this fall, I don't want her to think that 86%, that almost 90% of all of her peers will go off to college, be faced by one philosophy professor, and their faith will collapse because that's what everyone else does. That's not the statistical reality at all. They make good ad copy, but they're simply not true. I remember one well-known church planting trainer was saying 80% of church plants fail within the first year. 80% fail in a year. And I was like, I don't know that I've ever seen that. I've seen a lot of church plants. So we actually did a study. And it was fascinating because we did this study and we found that after 4 years, 67% of church plants were still viable, were still there. About half of them were doing well. And actually about 95% are still there after the first year. Yet, so I go to this person, I say lovingly, he's a friend, I say, brother, you're saying 80% of new church plants fail, but I actually studied over 2,000 church plants from 15 different denominations, and it's about 5%. So, I mean, that's not a rounding error. That's a 75% difference. And his answer to me was, well, I define failing different than you do. And so I said, do you define failing as people not going to your seminar? And he never changed it. So even today, you can Google that. And it's stunning to me where people will kind of draw a statistical line. But be careful about publicity stunts. Ask if such research reflects your observation. Ask if these stats are even knowable. So what do we know? Well, here's this, these graphs I'm about to give are all publicly available. They're in articles I've written for The Washington Post, CNN, and USA Today. And these are just charts from the General Social Survey. So the General Social Survey is the largest ongoing research project. It's University of Chicago, as a matter of fact. Largest ongoing research project. It used to be every year. Now it's every other year since 1972. Now, this, just out of interest, I want you to maybe shout a few numbers. What percentage of Americans do you think claimed to attend church regularly in the 40s? Just shout out some percentages. What do you, in the 40s, how high was church attendance? 70, 75, a lot in the 70s, okay. And what do you think, well, I already gave that, I already showed just 40. So the consensus in our room is that it was 70 to 75%, and now it's about 40%. So we're gonna look at that in just a minute. But we're going to look at that, looking first at Protestants and non-denominationals who regularly attend church. So that we're ruling out the Catholics, right? So that, and that with Catholics, Orthodox, others, that'd be half of our sample. But that basically is a decline, a pretty substantive decline. If we were at 80% down to 40%, it's that's a collapse. But 75 to 40%, that's a huge decline. Let's look at two things. First, let me tell you the actual numbers from Gallup, which has been tracking regular church attendance since the 40s. Here's what Gallup says. We're at the exact same place we were in 1946. Okay, so that's where we are in the U.S., the same place we were in the 1940s. The General Social Survey is a later player, and the General Social Survey actually starts in 1972. Here's a chart of Protestant and non-denominationals who regularly attend church charted out since 1972. I see several of you taking pictures. First of all, did I give permission for pictures? No. Secondly, you don't want a picture of this, download this. It's all online. Just look for this. This is in an article, The Washington Post on CNN, Christianity Isn't Dying. Shocking title, I know. So this is the General Social Survey. Now, for those of you who work with the General Social Survey, anybody ever done any work with the General Social Survey for religion research? No? why did I even ask that question? You know? it's actually, I have an article. If you use it, because some of you do research, will use it, and I just put out an article published in this month's Cambridge Journal of Religion and Politics that actually there's an error in the coding that we fixed at Lifeway Research. Can't find it right now, but it was undercounting evangelicals. So for people who've done research, the last 4 years on evangelicals, there was an error in the code that left out non-denominational evangelicals. So I'm going to show you why that's important in just a minute, since that's the largest and fastest growing segment of evangelicalism. So all the research you've seen the last 2 years, unless somebody wrote their own code, we write our own code, has actually left out that segment. And I'll show you why that matters in a minute. Okay, so this is not collapse. All right, some of you took stats in college. Look at the last year. What's the most likely direction the number goes up when the next data point goes out? Okay, it's down in the last year, 2014. What's the most likely place it goes next? Up. It's what we call a return to the mean. So the most likely situation, this is a down year, so it's a 20%. Actually, we got 23%. So the decline in Protestants and non-denominational. So this is mainline Protestants, evangelicals, and non-denominational. We have to count them separately because of the coding. Is that from 1972, you had 23%. Today, you have 20%. But if you average out the last few years, you're actually at 21 to 22%. So on a trend, you've declined by about 1 to 2% in church attendance. But Ed, everyone I know says it's declining. Well, if you're a mainline Protestant, it is. So this is mainline Protestantism. Let me explain the two charts, right? So the two lines on the chart. The top line is people who say they are. So we use the RELTRAD, which sits over the General Social Survey. That's the coding error that I mentioned. So the RELTRAD says that when they ask a question, what denomination are you, and they say Episcopal, we put them in a bucket that's mainline Protestantism, right? So in 1972, 28% of Americans answered questions in such a way that they were in that bucket. 8.6% were in that bucket and said they attended church regularly, which we're defining as three or more times per month. Okay, so during that time, mainline Protestantism has experienced a rather stunning collapse from 28% to 12.2%. Now, who say they are, to now only 3.6%, or about one out of every 30 people that you walk across in the street are regularly attending a mainline Protestant church. That's a pretty stunning decline. Now again, you say, but Ed, you're not a mainline Protestant. Actually, I deeply care about mainline Protestantism. I came to Christ in the Episcopal Church. I recently preached at the Cathedral of St. Luke of the Episcopal Diocese of Central Florida, where Greg Brewer serves as the bishop, and inside the Episcopal Church, not one of the newfangled Anglicans like Rick, but actual Episcopalians. And so I'm deeply concerned about mainline Protestantism, and mainline Protestantism is in historic trouble. If current trends continue, mainline Protestantism would cease to exist in 30 to 40 years. However, current trends don't continue. Things tend to trail off and just kind of lock in at a low level. Now let's take a look at evangelicals using the same metrics. Evangelicals in 1972 represented about 17% of the population. Today, they represent about 22% of the population by affiliation. And in 1972, about 8% of Americans were regularly attending an evangelical church. Today, it's about 12.5% of Americans. By the way, in case you're wondering, that's about a 50% increase. Furthermore, in the Pew study that just came out, the Pew study actually said, in the midst of all the headlines you saw, that evangelicals actually were the beneficiaries of the last 7 years. There are actually more evangelicals in 2014 than there were in 2007. And evangelicals were the only group who benefited from church switching among the major groups that were studied. So when you look at mainline Protestantism versus evangelicalism, you see a very different pattern. But most people in the news media are good people who are trying to report the news. They don't always understand us. I spoke a few years ago at the Washington Post building there in D.C., it's called the Religion Newswriters Association, and I was the only evangelical speaking that year, and they were all fascinated. They're like, "Do you like walk with your knuckles on the ground?" I mean, they were all fascinated, and I explained our research. I explained how we do research, but here's the thing: more and more reporters are becoming aware that evangelicals are the new mainline Protestants, and now I don't want you to miss this. So one out of eight Americans is a regular church attending evangelical. Two out of every eight Americans actually is an evangelical by self-definition. By the way, one of the questions that if I'm you in this political season I'm asking is that so are evangelicals really who everyone says evangelicals are? And the answer is yes and no. I was at a meeting that I'm not allowed to mention where I was, but it was a lot of evangelical leaders in a national evangelical meeting. We were associated together. And what we're talking about, well, those aren't our people. Those are our people. Now, there is a correlation between the more you go to church, the less likely you actually were to vote for Donald Trump. However, still, a whole lot of church-going evangelicals are the ones who are voting for Donald Trump. So a correlation doth not make an exclusion. But here's the reality. If one out of eight Americans are regular church-attending evangelicals, and another one out of eight are evangelicals who are not regular church-attending, those evangelicals who are not regular church attending, I actually have an article that I don't know will ever publish, but it was titled, "That Nominal Evangelicals Are the Worst People Ever." Say, that sounds terrible. But here's why. Nominal evangelicals look at porn, beat their wives, steal, gamble, all these indicators that we would generally think are bad, at a higher level than the general population. Not at a higher level than the active evangelicals, but at a higher level than the general population. So there's something to the fact that if you grew up in a religious conservative environment and you subsequently were uninvolved and unengaged in that environment, that your life is actually worse off, because maybe a dog returns, you know, to its, Jesus talks about a dog returning to its vomit. So there's something to that that is worth noting. We don't have time to unpack that because I want to make sure that I don't take too much time, make sure Rick has time. So what are we seeing in the numbers? Here's what we're seeing in the numbers. A real breakout in the last few years of non-denominational evangelicals, which, remember, was left out of the Reltrad coding, so that's one of the reasons you'll see some all the books in the last couple of years that relied, for full details, since we're recording this, the University of Indiana kind of hosts for the Society for the Scientific Study of Religion. They hosted the coding on their site. That coding was wrong, and people have been using it for years, and it left out non-denominational evangelicals. Now, they've taken it down since then. We're kind of hosting the coding at our lifewayresearch.com/Reltrad site, and so you can get that information there. But when we actually use the Reltrad coding, which was developed to determine these things, the blue line is actually non-denominational evangelicals. I mean, the stunning breakout of non-denominational evangelicals is worthy of our notice. Now, I just baselined from 1972 to 1976. From there, I then tracked the percent change year to year. And you see some bubbling here about non-denominational evangelicalism here, but then it really begins to take off. Now, there's a lot of different reasons for that, right? Some of it is people leaving traditional denominations. Assemblies of God's growing. 25 consecutive years of growth for the Assemblies of God. I had the privilege of participating in their news release celebration of that. 25 years. Southern Baptists, on the other hand, have been declining now for 8 consecutive years, and that decline is accelerating. They're declining about the rate that non-denominational evangelicals are picking up. So is there a correlation? Haven't studied it, but I'm guessing there's some connection between the two. So what's happening is simultaneously, society's becoming more secular. Church attendance is remaining relatively steady, declining a little bit. We saw that. But what's happening is who those people are is changing. They're becoming increasingly non-denominational evangelicals. And Christianity in America is becoming more evangelical. For the first time this year, using Pew's formulation of what's an evangelical, for the first time this year, the majority of people in America who regularly attend any church of any kind are evangelicals. So the first time in America, the majority of regular church attenders are evangelicals. So there's people always have trends. They say, Ed, what are the trends? There's only one trend inside Protestantism or American Christianity right now. Every other trend is a counter trend. Okay? The trend to liturgy is a counter trend. The trend to house churches is a counter trend. I'm not saying there aren't people who are on that counter trend, but every single trend other than this one is a counter trend. The trend is to large, non-denominational contemporary churches with smoke machines. Well, the smoke machines is technically not part of it, but that's the trend. You say, but Ed, I know all these people who are going liturgical. I know you do. And that's sometimes a result of where we are, right? I was quoted in the Washington Post one time about Wheaton College, and I didn't know I'd end up working there later. And they asked me, so is this a trend towards liturgical worship? I said, yeah, if you're a student at Wheaton College. And they actually quoted it. And so what happens is sometimes our institutions, which, you know, we come out and we're in this new time of learning, and then we get kind of connected, enthusiastic about history. And so there is an interest in those things. People are walking the Canterbury Trail. People are swimming rivers in Rome and Constantinople, right? But the trend is to large non-denominational churches, and to the point now we're among evangelicals that a third, don't miss this, a third of evangelicals now are non-denominational. Now, what does that mean for the future? Well, it means some challenge for the traditional denominations, right? It's a remapping of Protestantism. I just received a grant. Next year, my major research project will be. It's called Entrepreneurial Evangelicalism and the Remapping of Protestantism. Because I think this impact is huge and has not been studied a lot. But this is the major trend within. Now, real quickly, I just want to touch on. I'm going to try to stick to 30 minutes from when I started, so Rick can have the rest of the time, and then we'll do some Q&A. I know I'm going quickly, but again, all this stuff's online. I'm happy to give you the PowerPoint too, if you'd like. I'll email it to whoever has your email addresses, and we'll get that. What about those dropouts? Well, what is the dropout number? Well, it's really, really hard to track that with any level of certainty, because you have to have a sample, and you have to have a sample willing to actually, if you're going to do real research, and you know, the Fuller Institute for Youth Ministry has done some good work on this, others have. I think the best study is actually from the University of Southern California. It was published the end of last year, I guess a year ago now. It's by USC faculty, and it was published in Oxford University Press. I mean, so this is not some, you know, off-the-wall organization. They followed 300-plus families, three generations, and here's what they found. Jews, evangelicals, Mormons, and nuns are the best at passing on their religion to their children. Here's actual numbers. And by the way, when the evangelical parents are married, the number actually goes into the high 60s, and some other factors take it into the low 70s. Obviously, the loser here is mainline Protestantism. Now, keep in mind, too, that some evangelicals become Catholics, and some Catholics became mainline Protestants, and it doesn't mean they all left. You know, some evangelicals are in Methodist churches, which are often included, the Reltrad are included in mainline Protestant, though most Methodist churches actually lean evangelical. So you say, Ed, well, what then's the picture? Well, in 30 minutes, not the easiest thing to do, but let me end with just a picture that I think will help us where we are. Right now, our culture is in the U.S., and my apologies, I recognize not everyone's from the U.S., but just kind of sticking with my assignment, is that you kind of take it into two big categories, right? Non-Christians are 25% of the population. Christians are 70 to 75% of the population. You say, Ed, you don't really believe that, do you? No, I don't. But let me explain. It's very hard to go to. I work with a reporter, and she always says to me, how come you always want to say people who say they're on your team aren't on your team? She's of another religion. So she said, if 75% of people say they're Christians, shouldn't you be excited about that? I said, well, but that's not what we think it means. So I explained, and then she said, well, you should write an article. So I wrote an article, and it's what they always say. And I published this in USA Today. If you're interested, you can read this in USA Today, where I tried to explain a little bit what's going on. Because you have to look at this more broadly than two categories. 25% of Americans are not Christians. About half of them are not Christians because they're something else. They're Buddhists, they're Jewish, they're Muslims. Half of the 25% are not Christians because they're secular. But most Americans, even those we would not count as part of the Christian team, consider themselves Christians. And so we need some categorization that takes their census questions, their survey questions, and so when you look at it, you kind of have two teams in our culture, right? You've got, and again, I'm simplifying this, and please forgive the teams, because I'm going to explain more in a minute, but you've got a small percentage of people in America who are actually devoutly secular. Atheism is not a big cultural phenomenon, it's a big publishing phenomenon. About 5 to 6% of Americans say that they're atheists, about 5 to 6% say they were atheists about 20 years ago. Okay, there's not a big shift in atheism, it's just gotten more press. What has changed, though, there are something. So if I can use my hand, 25% non-Christian, 75% Christian, but you really got to divide them into quartiles. Dividing them into quartiles, you get that about 25% of Americans, or a third of the Christians on our Christian team, are cultural Christians. They haven't been to church, they probably won't be there at Easter, they won't be there at Christmas time. But if you ask them, are you a Christian, they will say yes, because they mean a good person, or they mean not a Muslim or not a Jew. So they will answer, yes. Okay, they're cultural Christians. They're Christians by their cultural background. About 25%, one quartile of Americans, are actually congregational Christians. They have a loose connection. You'll see them this Sunday. You might see them at Christmas. That's why we call them Christers, Christmas and Easter Christians. Now, are they Christians? Well, again, we define Christian different than everybody else, so hold off on that for a second. But they call themselves Christians. So now we get to the place where 50%, don't miss this, half of America calls itself a Christian, but is a nominal Christian, the way we as evangelicals would define it. And so 25% of Americans are actually convictionally Christian. They call themselves Christians, And it's meaningful to their lives. They choose where they go to school. They choose who they're going to marry. They choose what they do on the weekends in light of this conviction, where the prior two Christian categories did nothing like that. Now, this includes evangelicals, mainline Protestants, Catholics, and Mormons. Hence, I am not making a theological description or agreeing with their self-identification as an evangelical researcher. However, what I'm saying to you is that about half of this population is actually us. We're about half of the convictional Christian population. Now, here's the thing I want you to see. You say, Ed, you say there's not been this huge drop-off in church attendance, but it sure feels like it. Yes, it does. Here's why. What's happened is that the secular worldview, which is actually a minority in self-identification, has now begun to impact cultural Christians and congregational Christians to the place now where convictional Christianity seems out of place and out of step with the cultural norm. So though the majority of Americans still think of themselves and call themselves Christians, you take it far too seriously, and ultimately we are out of step with society as a whole, which now has flipped. And though self-identification is minimal, I mean, it's growing, you know, the nuns are growing as a percentage and a phenomenon, but their influence is far, far beyond their size. Because here's the deal, the cultural Christians are really just as secular as the secular people. Now, I'll tell you personally, my own family, I come from a family that's not Christians, as we would identify Christians, and my own family, many of whom hadn't been to church in 30, 40, 50 years, have now stopped calling themselves Christians, but their behavior hasn't changed in decades. But 10 years ago, they called themselves Christians. Now, in some ways, the cultural cachet of calling yourself a Christian has been lost. And so what's happened is more and more people are now self-identifying as, I'm really nothing. And now you don't have to be an atheist. No one wants to be an atheist because nobody likes atheists. I mean, statistically, nobody likes atheists. People say nobody likes evangelicals. No, nobody likes atheists. I mean, look at the numbers. Matter of fact, one of the more fascinating things in this current election cycle is Bernie Sanders. The first openly secular candidate who has gathered the hearts and minds of the next generation, who's just openly secular. And, you know, kind of a little bit of nod that there's something out there, but it's openly secular. Every candidate until this election cycle had to in some way pretend they were religious. And a lot of them were really good at pretending, both Democrats and Republicans. So what's happened, this is what I want you to see. We were really never, this pattern has been pretty similar for about 30, 40 years. We've never been a religious majority as convictional Christians. But now we're acknowledging we're a convictional minority. The reality is that leads for some challenges up ahead. Because there was always this buffer, right? This was the team, right? There was this buffer. They didn't always do everything we did, but they'd sort of defend us if they needed to defend us. They'd sort of say, well, they get to decide what's right and wrong. They get to define terms about morality and marriage and culture. Well, now all of a sudden, they're not so much thinking that we get to decide a whole lot. The Hollywood, when it was creating its film standards board, you know what they did? They went to the Catholic Church to help us create a film standards board. I assure you, they are not calling the Catholic Church today, except to say, what would make you really, really mad? So what's happened is that the worldview has shifted while the identification has not shifted a whole lot. And I don't want you to miss this. Attendance has neither collapsed or drastically declined in decades. What's happened is, so statistically, the sky is not falling, but the ground is certainly shifting. And so what we have to prepare ourselves for is for a new place of ministry where we've lost our home field advantage, where many people still keep the name, and a few of them are dropping the name Christian, but ultimately, the squishy middle is not holding. This is the fastest shrinking. This is the fastest growing. This is relatively steady. I want you not to miss this, okay? Because this is the story. If you don't get the nuance of research, this is the fastest shrinking, but the largest group of people will reach, nominal Christians. This is the fastest growing, but not that big right now. And this has remained relatively steady. That's the nuance of research. So how might we engage an increasingly secular world? We've got a mission field that's changing, a mission force that needs fresh new ways to be engaging. I'm going to ask my friend to come talk about that very thing. Would you welcome Rick Richardson?
I love Ed Stetzer. I have gotten to hang around with him. We're working together some at the Billy Graham Center, and he loves to talk about changing the world, and I've jumped in with him and shared that. So I love Ed Stetzer. I don't always love following him because it's just so stimulating and engaging. And what I'm going to do is hit the pause button for you to jot down any questions you have from his presentation, so that when we come back to question and answer, you can pick up with what your mind is thinking about right now. If we went into question and answer, I probably wouldn't get to talk then about the unchurched and how we reach them, and I'm going to do that, but I'd love you to be able to come back to your questions. So hit the pause button, take a moment. Good. I'm going to now share about the churchless, and the statistics will match pretty much what Ed did, but I do want to say a word about the different ways we count. Ed mentioned the RELTRAD, or religious tradition, really got generated by a group of sociologists and sociologists tend to believe that what defines you is who you gather with. And so it's not done by phone surveys of what people believe or tests about what they believe, it's where they affiliate. And so that's why then the RELTRAD measures affiliation, and so then you have to decide what denominations you're going to put in the bucket of each of these categories. And I'm getting into the weeds on all this right now because I'm working some with Christian Smith on a project, the Notre Dame sociologist, about what has happened to the evangelical kids based on his emerging adult research. Actually wading into his research and counting evangelicals, because he did a whole book on Catholics and found out that about 1 in 6 Catholics are still committed Catholics 10 years later after high school. 1 in 6. And then he kind of described their journey. And but as Ed mentioned, nobody's done that kind of research as much with evangelicals. And part of it is counting them is not easy, figuring out who to count. Now, so we're wading into the weeds in that and, you know, are finding how each group counts evangelicals. And it differs. Barna has probably the narrowest way to count evangelicals and uses about 8 or 9 categories to define them and comes up with a much smaller percentage. So you have all the way from RELTRAD, which is religious tradition, which is affiliation, and you know, what you put down on a survey that you're aligned with, all the way down to measures of belief or behavior and so forth. So that's part of what you get into when statistics differ, and you obviously have to really think about what are people counting? What's the measure? And how do you use that? So I want to start with a story to make the transition from what Ed focused on to what I'm going to focus on. And it comes from when I was 6 years old. When I was 6 years old, I lived in North Carolina and had 2 brothers, and my dad was in the military. He was at a military base, a Marine base down there. And we lived in one bungalow, and right across the sidewalk in another bungalow was another family whose dad was in the military, and they had 3 girls. And so it was kind of 3 boys, 3 girls right across the way. This is match made in heaven, enchanting love story about to start. And so we each Friday would pile into a big, ugly green station wagon and drive to the beach. And at the beach, we would play around in the sand and the surf and then drive home. And one of the Fridays, we were driving home and singing kind of fun travel songs. I don't know how many of you have ever sang the song or sung the song, whatever I should say, sung the song Noah's Arky-Arky. And the animals, they came in by twosies-twosies. And, you know, the giraffesies, and it goes on and on. Come on, own up. How many have ever sung that song? Come on. Boy, only about 5 of us. See, that shows we're globalizing. Bless the Lord. And but we're singing that song, and suddenly Allison, the youngest girl, kind of says, "Hey, where's Chris?" And Chris is my 3-year-old brother. And he was kind of a trickster, so we look in the wheel well, we look under the beach blankets, we look everywhere we can, and he's not in the car, and we're about 40 minutes away from the beach. So I say to my mom, "Hey, Mom, Chris isn't here." And my mom goes, What? Like that, because she thought I was kidding, and then she realized I wasn't, and then she panicked. And when she panicked, we almost lost our lives, because she first hit the brake, then slammed the accelerator, whipped the wheel around. We did a wheelie on the side wheels in that big, ugly green station wagon, turned around. She hit the accelerator again, and we topped 100 miles per hour many years ago in a big, ugly station wagon going back to the beach. We got to the beach. We got into the beach, go through the, you know, guard, the big arches, check every guard station, and at the last guard station, there's my brother, big tear coming down his eyes. I saw him first. Then he sees my mom, his mom, my mom sees him, and they rush together and twirl around like a big cheesy Hollywood movie. You know, the great reuniting, they're happy, joyful, tears are coming down. And I thought, boy, for me, that's been kind of a parable of the ways in which the church is called to notice who isn't there, either isn't there yet or isn't there anymore, and is called to do whatever it takes to get back to the beach and find the person who ought to be there. Whether they are lost now, have always been lost, have drifted, whatever the reason. And for me, that big, ugly green station wagon is a great parable for maybe the majority of the churches in the country. Right? There are many large mega churches that have a great ministry. They feel a little bit like, you know, how you'd go and buy an upscale car. But the majority of churches in the U.S. average 100. And that's the majority of the kind of stations that need to, in a sense, experience transformation to reach people. And so the big ugly green station wagon is a great picture. Chris, my son, my brother Chris is a good example too, because he is like a dropout, right? He stayed at the beach. He did have a church background in the ugly big green station wagon, but now he's not there anymore. And actually, a majority of the people we're trying to reach are in that category, or many are. And so I like to think about that, but the biggest hero of the story for me is my mom. Now, she always says, don't tell that story because I left my kid at the beach. And I say, but mom, right? But we've come to terms with that. I said, Mom, you're my hero. You're the God figure. Because as soon as you knew he wasn't there, you risked all of our lives to turn that thing around and get back to the beach and find him and get him back in the station wagon. And I thought, that's what God's like. And God is looking for station wagon drivers, pastors, leaders, many of us in this room who are going to have that kind of attitude and heart to go after the people who are unchurched. And so I want to look at that segment of people who are unchurched. This counting is a little different. It's done by surveys and phone surveys of people. And it includes their self-identification. But it's stats based on those kinds of surveys done by Lifeway and also done by Barna. So it's a different method of counting. But I want to talk a little bit about that. And first I want to just kind of show my... So I'm going to talk about the unchurched and then the church, and then what churches are doing to reach them and some of what we jumped into there. So I got to show you this cool PowerPoint my TA just did today. Is it coming? Whoa. I mean, wow. Anyway, so a church list combining Lifeway and Barna data. So just some of the things. And so an unchurched person in a lot of this research is someone who has not attended a Christian church service other than a special event at any time during the past 6 months. And what you begin to realize with that definition is who's churched and who isn't is a fluid concept. And people actually go through cycles of connecting and not connecting. And what that means is there are some of you in this room who might be churchless right now, even though you attend Trinity. Because if you were called, you haven't been to church in a while. Now, maybe nobody here, but I'm just saying, that's the kind of fluidity that often occurs in the kind of churchless thing that we look at, or unchurched. 156 million adults and children are unchurched or churchless. In the U.S., that would make it the eighth most populous nation. 49% are actively churched. Those who attend a church regularly, once a month or so. So again, how you count. These aren't the 3 month or more, but at least once a month or so, 49% actively churched. 8% minimally churched, they go maybe three times a year, are not regularly in church. 33%, and this is where it gets close to what Ed is saying, and it's very important, 33% are the de-churched, those who have been churched in the past but are currently on hiatus. Now, here was one of the fascinating things to me when I went to Burning Man, which is a large arts and self-expression festival held in the Nevada desert every year over Labor Day for a week. It's a kind of neo-pagan festival, and we go with Wheaton's blessing and some of Wheaton's money. I maybe shouldn't have said that and all of that. Here's what I shouldn't say. The provost actually, no, I better not say that. Anyway, we go every year, and we interview people. We're doing research on burners. And so far, 90% of the burners that I have interviewed in lots of crazy places, doing lots of crazy things, 90% have a significant church background. And this is at a place that primarily draws from California, like large percentages from California. A lot of people who are a little more hostile to the church. And in that place, 90% are the de-churched. And that's not unusual in our culture. And it's part of what we have to think about as we think about who we're reaching and how we're reaching them. One way to look at that is it's a negative because they've been inoculated. They know what it is that we're offering, and they decided they don't want it. Another way to look at it is that actually, of those 90% of the people that I've interviewed, most of them were not at all hostile to church. We have a huge sense that people are hostile to church. I'll show you a stat on that in a minute. Then finally, 10% are the purely unchurched, people who have never attended a church service. That's not the picture we would often have as we think about our culture. This is not, again, this is how you count, so it's not in tension with the stats that Ed shared. Trends, in the 1990s, 30% were churchless, in the 2000s, 33% were churchless, in 2010s, 43%. So again, this isn't the RELTRAD variable, which talks about your religious affiliation or identification. This is whether you go to church once or more a month. What are the attitudes toward church on the part of the unchurched? 66% are favorable, 28% neutral, 7% believe church is a negative factor to a community, and only 15% express interest in attending a church. I think that's a MythBuster slide. We think that there is so much negative attitude. Now, there is negative attitude toward churches that become very public and judgmental about sexuality, sexual orientation, and so forth, but that's a factor. But the reality is there isn't the huge groundswell against the church that we are sure we are going out into every time we step out the door. An attitude toward faith and spirituality, this wouldn't be a surprise or a myth buster. 66% of the unchurched say they are spiritual people. 65% still consider themselves Christian of the unchurched. So that's different than the population as a whole. 65% of the unchurched. 58% say they pray to God during a typical week, and 57% their religious faith is very important in their life today. I mean, look at almost 60% say they pray to God during a typical week. I show my class, we're having a class on gospel, church, and cultures, and I show my class a sort of a video of our team at Burning Man. One of the fun things is one of my students from Wheaton produced a documentary that showed on national Canadian television about our time there, and we interview lots of people in the documentary, and you know, and it's kind of a fun thing, but it's just fascinating to see the level. A lot of people think of it as a neo-pagan spiritual, a neo-pagan festival. The spiritual interest is very intense at that place. And yes, some of it's, one of my students said, how much of it is fueled by mushrooms and ecstasy and all that? And I said, okay, there is some of it fueled by that. And those are the kinds of spiritual experiences people are having. But Harold, I'm so thankful you challenged me as we did this course. Pay attention to the spiritual diversity that's emerging. And so another thing I did, I probably shouldn't say this either, as we as a class went and visited to get into dialogue and actually think about missionally, the Soka Gakkai International Buddhist Center downtown. It's about three doors away from the condo that I'm in. And it's really been fun to get into that dialogue and see this other faith, the way it's operating, and then actually enter into relationship enough so that you start to rethink how mission happens. And that's what we're finding at Burning Man, is actually a lot of formerly churched people who are looking to Buddhism and others, but they wouldn't identify themselves as Buddhists, but they learn from Buddhists. They use that language. And there's kind of a broad cultural influence. So 50% claim to be actively seeking something better. 40% of young unchurched talk about faith matters with friends and family. So what's the past and present religious allegiance? 75% were formerly churched, of the unchurched again. 33% are former Catholics. And 12%, and this matches the figure Ed mentioned, 12% align with other religions, including 4% Jews, 4% Eastern religions, 2% Muslims, 1% other faiths. So that's a quick take. Many in each of those categories don't attend any religious service. There's also, interestingly enough, born again, defined by Jesus Christ. They have a personal commitment to Jesus Christ and believe they will go to heaven because they have confessed their sins. There's 18 million of those who are churchless right now. And if all of them returned, the average church would grow by 50 adults. Every church in America would grow if you split them between all the Protestant churches, okay, so that doesn't include the Catholic, but every church would grow by 50 adults if we just got the born-agains back. Wow. So how do you reach them? 20% would be more interested in attending a church if a friend invited them, 20%. So there's like 1 in 5 is kind of the best you get in terms of the approaches of reaching people. Friendship invitation, events, a leader from a church visiting them in a home. And two of the most important ways these days to position yourself as a church that draws unchurched is that you serve the needs of the poor and that you're intergenerational and mentor younger leaders. So more than 4 out of 5 of the unchurched know Christian personally. Just 15% say that the lifestyles of the Christians they know are noticeably more positive than the norm. So what time am I aiming to end for questions, Ed? What time did you give me? What?
I think you're supposed to go 30 minutes, okay?
Yeah, what time did you hand me the mic? You have no idea. What's that?
I'm going to smoke. I don't know.
Yeah, I'll go out. I got to smoke, okay. Did I join you? No. So, in some ways, 30 years ago, the most effective form of evangelism was widely believed to be straight-out confrontational. A decade or two ago, it became relational. Are we undergoing another shift today where in doing good in the world, social engagement is becoming the primary apologetic? It's a question. Always remembering we must, in the words of Ed Stetzer, show and share the love of Jesus. So that gives you some stuff about the unchurched and their openness to church, their spirituality. What are churches doing to reach them? That's a project we're in the middle of right now. So I can't tell you what statistically tell you what we found yet. We're actually doing a conference in June called Amplify on evangelism. And that's when we're going to unveil kind of the statistics of what we've learned this year on our study of the unchurched, and then also what the churches that are best reaching the unchurched are doing. So we're pretty excited about that. But what I can tell you is that I've been involved in cohorting senior pastors for the last couple of years. And I've cohorted about 37 senior pastors, and we're ready to kind of go more public in what we've learned. And I want to give you just a couple of things that we're learning. One is that most senior pastors are not involved much in personal witness themselves. Most are having trouble reaching friends and neighbors, reaching out in their networks and neighborhoods. And as a result, they're having trouble leading their churches in doing that. And so one of the things we've discovered is senior pastors really need help. to actually have personal witness, personal evangelism, become a vibrant, vital, growing part of their lives. And if they don't get that help, and if they don't move forward in that way, their church is just not going to grow by conversion. So that's one thing we found. But another thing we've discovered is that a lot of churches have a model, like you can't just have a pastor that reaches out. You've actually also got to lead in the culture of your church in ways that change your church. Because our churches need often a culture change in order to build bridges for the unchurched. So I watched this happen with my friend Kevin Harney some years ago. He took a church called Corinth Reformed Church near Grand Rapids. It's in Byron Center, Michigan, or something. I think that's the name of the town. And do you know about him? Or so, yeah, it's a good church these days. A number of years ago, the church called my friend Kevin up, and he said, "Hey, Kevin, we think you're supposed to be the senior pastor." And Kevin said, "Not, no way, not, no how. I'm not looking for a place to go." So then they called him like 3 or 4 weeks in a row, and finally he said, "Well, okay, I'll have a conversation with you. Just come on this such and such a day." And he tells it like this. He says, "I didn't even get out of my dungarees and my sweatshirt and my paint clothes because that was my day off, and I wasn't even interested in going to this church." And they brought their elder team down, and they sat in the living room and basically had a conversation where Ed says, "I don't think your church, which is 100 years old, and has only grown to 300 in that 100 years. You've grown 3 people a year for about 100 years. And your church is basically 3 extended families that have just had a lot of births and married people into that. So that's your church of 300. So I don't really think you're going to want to reach the unchurched." And they said, "We do. We think you're supposed to be our pastor." He said, "You're going to have to be willing to change your worship service. You're going to have to be willing to consider the needs of outsiders in how you design all that. You're going to have to sacrifice and pay for the people that aren't here yet. You're going to have to, I'm going to be like, you know, he's going to be like my mom. I'm going to turn you almost on your side to bring the changes that are needed for you to reach the unchurched." And they said, "We think you're supposed to be our pastor." He said, "No, I'm not." And finally, one woman on the way out said, "I think you should pray about it." So they all leave, and he goes and tells his wife, Sherry. He said, "Man, they just won't let me alone. The one woman at the end says, I think you should pray about it." And his wife turned to him and said, "Well, maybe you should." And so he did. And so then he said, "Okay, I want you to gather all the adults of your church. I'll come up there and I'm going to interview you." What the way to get a church, right? So he goes up and he interviews the adults and he tells them all the sacrifices they're going to have to make. And they still said he's supposed to be their pastor. So he came and led a 100-year-old, 300-person traditional church into a massive cultural change that led to the church growing to 1,100, 1,200, and growing primarily through conversion growth. That's the culture change that we need across the country in lots of our churches. You know, is it easier to start from scratch? You know, somebody puts it, is it easier to have a baby or raise the dead? Well, really, neither of them are easy, right? But both are critical. And so we're on a goal right now to work with senior pastors. And what we're doing is we're helping them. So here's one of the amazing things to me. We get senior pastors together once a month, and we tell stories and keep them accountable to their personal witness. And we ask them every time, "What's your evangelism temperature on a scale of 1 to 10, and what do you want to do to grow it?" And then we tell stories about our personal relationships. You would not believe what happens in pastors' lives. They all come in, "I'm a 2, I'm a 3, I haven't had a conversation in years." That's stage 1. Not years, but not lately. The only time they have conversations is when people bring other people to them. Not in their neighborhoods and networks. So they're not modeling what their people need to do. So they started at 2 or 3. Then there's a whole period where they tell all the stories about the people other people brought them. And they know that's not what we're asking, but that's the only thing they got. And then they start to move into a period where they're reaching out, getting into neighborhoods and networks, seeing people come to Christ. I think of my friend Reese, who actually leads an evangelistic church, actually associated with Willow Creek Church. He loves evangelism. They're seeing people come to faith. But this is exactly the stage he went through because he's so busy leading a church. 2 or 3, nobody. 3 or 4 people that people bring me. And then he started reaching out in his neighborhoods and networks. And he talked with one neighbor and he sort of did it too quickly and invited them to a service right away. And they were awkward for the next 6 months. I mean, he crashed and burned, right? 6 months later, he invited them over for a barbecue. They got to know each other. 6 months after that, that family came to church, banged on his door to go out for dinner afterwards. And now Reese has a story. And he is so excited. Now he's joined a health club. And there are 9 women and 2 men in it. And that's his community now. And he's reaching out like he never has before. And now all his staff are catching it. That's the kind of culture change. So that's one issue, is how do you help people kind of take that step? And what I found is, and so I'd just suggest that to you all, are you in any kind of context where at least monthly somebody's checking up on you about your outreach temperature and giving you an opportunity to tell your stories and encouraging you and investing in you so that you're growing that way? I have seen that be very transformational for pastors. But the second thing is, you can't just see our personal lives start to change a little bit. The ecosystem of the church has to begin to change. And there, the key is working from our strengths to turn those strengths into strengths that reach out to people outside of our congregation. And we call it 2% vector rule. How do you take your best ministries and get them 2% more into the world? True North for most churches is whoever's gathered here. And we spend the money and set up the budget to spend it on the folks that are already gathered. The 2% vector says, hey, do you provide meals for people that are sick or have experienced trauma or loss who are in your church? Could you vector that 2% and get the people in your congregation starting to offer meals to people in your neighborhoods and networks that are going through trauma? That was a strength of the church. They 2% vectored it and began to have a culture change in their church. And if you could get every leader in your church starting to think in terms of that change, that would have a huge impact on your culture. So that's one thing we've been working with these senior pastors on, is that 1 degree, 30-day accountability. The second is the kind of 2% vector. And then the third piece is, think about the journey non-Christians make. And I wish I had time to share this, but it's kind of we've adapted Andy Stanley's house diagram so that it's no longer an attractional diagram, what happens, you know, on the front porch and in your foyer and in your living room, but it actually starts on the streets, so that with your neighborhoods and networks. And have you thought as a church about how you help people make the journey from the streets to the porch, to the foyer, to the living and dining room, to the kitchen and garage, and out back to the streets? Do you have a process as a church or a ministry that actually helps people take the steps they need to take? And one of the fun things, I've been working with my friend Dave Ferguson, who's at Community Christian Church, and we're developing, we're respelling evangelism for people. So evangelism is sharing and showing the love of Jesus Christ to the world in such a way that they can respond and come to Christ. And we've been respelling evangelism as B-L-E-S-S. And I'm going to end with this story. There's a study by Mark Russell, got turned into a doctoral dissertation. And Mark Russell was a researcher who went to Thailand and studied 12 businesses mission organizations. 6 of them were there with the stated goal of converting people, and he called them the converters. 6 of the organizations were there you know, primarily to start businesses that survived, that thrived, that hired Thais to do work, and that really blessed the economy and the people there. And so Mark Russell called them the blessers. So there were the converters, there were the blessers. He watched them over a several-year period, and he came to two conclusions. One of them, not surprising, the other quite surprising. The first conclusion was that the blessers had blessed a lot better than the converters. They'd hired more Thais, they'd built more successful businesses, they were more accepted by the community, they had a better reputation, and they had blessed. That wasn't so surprising. Here's what was surprising. The blesser businesses had seen more conversions by a ratio of 48 to 1. I would suggest that part of why we have struggles is because evangelism in a sales model has become what we do to people to get them to become part of our church or community or make some kind of commitment, rather than how we bless people in their lives in such a way that ultimately they get a choice to embrace Jesus or not. And so we're working on the five missional bless practices that will change the way you and your church relate to the world. Let's begin with prayer. B, listen, eat, serve, and story. Now we bless in order to be a blessing like Abraham was. Genesis 12, I will make you a blessing to all the nations. Bless isn't enough, because we show and we share the love of Christ. And we challenge people to come to Christ. So blessing is invite, news, and grow. But initially, we want to reframe what people think what the heck they think it is, so that they understand it as an expression of love to people in a way that will overwhelm people. And the challenge is coming, but it starts with that blessing. And I just want to leave you with that. The blessers saw more people converted by a ratio of 48 to 1. And I wouldn't be surprised if in our culture, that attitude today marks churches that are seeing more and more unchurched come to Christ. I wouldn't be surprised. That's what our research is working on. We'll let you know in June at Amplify. I hope you can join us. Question and answer.
And I will bring the mic to you so that we capture it as well on.
Do you want a chair? If you want a chair.
No, I'm good. I mentioned, so, Rick mentioned that we're actually doing a big research project, largest research project ever done of its kind, on effective evangelistic churches and unchurched people. We'll roll. Is that me?
Hope so.
We'll roll both of those out at the Amplify conference this summer, which is just at Wheaton College. We got a few lightweights coming in, Luis Palau, Bill Graham, Lee Strobel, Alan Hirsch, Beth, no less, the amazing Beth will be there. And so Kim Reisman, head of World Methodist Evangelism, she's amazing. I was talking to her today. We got a great
Derwin
group. Derwin Gray,
pretty multi-ethnic. Peter Hong is going to be there.
Peter's
James
be there.
Chung, James Meeks. So pretty cool.
Yeah. So do I need to make this go away? Is that me? No, yes, maybe. Somebody? It's you. It is.
We're sensitive.
It's you, because every time you move, it makes the noise. Yeah, that's really irritating. Stop.
Check. 1, 2. Here we go. All right. Question right here. No, just hold up.
Oh yeah, from bad to worse. Great mic.
I would just like for you to repeat the last four anachronisms that you just said, bless.
Bless. So begin with prayer, So that's praying with people and for people. Listen, that's listening to people about God and listening to God about people. Eat, that's providing hospitality that creates belonging and acceptance. Serve, and actually serve is not just, you know, you've heard when helping hurts. Serve is actually mutually serving. Serving others and also asking to be served by others, sometimes that's the most powerful way we build connection with people. And too often evangelism is a power thing we come down on people with. I've been inviting my friends into my class, and my students get to hear my friends who I'm reaching out to teach them and teach me, and I'm seeing them move toward Christ because they have the power. And so that's a way to serve. And then story. How do we tell our hear their story and tell our story and communicate God's story?
The verdict has been that it was me, not you. It's not me, it's you.
We will at Amplify, by the way, roll out a bunch of stuff on that. So, yeah.
Thank you for the opportunity to interact today. Thank you so much for the time. One of the areas which I'd love to hear a little more is coming from a missions context, and actually the point of bless, and you mentioned Genesis 12, the Abraham, be a blessing to all of the nations. And some of the huge trends that from a more missions context we're seeing in the United States, the MPI, Migration Policy Institute, says that somewhere around 80% of the growth of our United States is actually through first-generation immigrants and their families. And as we even look at this wonderful room, I celebrate the kingdom here today.
Man.
Celebrate the kingdom here today. This is a sign to me of the fulfillment of God's promises to all tribes, tongues, and nations. Already looking at Revelation 7, where we're headed. Anyways, I wonder if you could speak a little bit more into the globalization and this very question of being a blessing to the nations and the whole immigration question and are enlarging the tent, so to speak. I personally know of Brazilian brothers right here, huge Asian, South Asian, India, China, and as our world is changing, so must our churches at some point. So I wonder if you could speak into that. I also do know of 1,600 Chinese churches now in the United States. This is just the last 20 years. 1,600 Chinese churches here in the United States. 400, I'm going next month to a gathering of 400 Brazilian pastors.
You just want to preach, brother. Just keep going.
Yeah, keep going.
Someone give him a Bible.
Amen, brother.
Let him work the
you're
text.
You're asking and answering.
Speak into that.
Well, it's a great question. Who are the Brazilians, by the way?
Right here?
Very good. My daughter, when she was 15, I shipped her off to João Pessoa. To Cidade Viva, where she lived, and for 6 months, she speaks Portuguese, and so she's so there you go. Tudo bem. Anyway, again, part of the challenges. You're right on, but the people who asked us, they only gave us like an hour, and they don't love Jesus like you do, because if they love Jesus like you do, we could talk about globalization for an hour and days, et cetera, et cetera. But the carnality of those who invited us forced us into a brief subject. So let me just say that the evangelicals that we're tracking, that evangelicals, if you eliminated the growing multiculturalism of evangelicalism, white evangelicalism has been in decline since the 70s. And so I think what you're finding is evangelicalism is in a great season of transition. That transition, I think, needs to be reflected in its leadership. It's not yet reflected as much in its leadership as it is in its rank and file. However, I think that you're right, and the multicultural change and shift that's taking place here, but let alone, I mean, you talk about globalization. Let's talk about the church in Brazil. Let's celebrate that Brazil is now the second largest mission-sending country in the world. But let's also caution that we love Pentecostals. We're not so excited about neo-Pentecostalism. And so there are challenges that are there, too. But so do we address, you know, so we talk about the universal church and some of those things. So there are challenges, but they're different in each place that we go. But what we're finding is that the church, the Big C Church, in North America is behind but catching up to society around. I mean, some of you be Canadians. Vancouver and Toronto both have more people born outside of Canada than inside of Canada, right? And so the churches often reflect that. Sometimes they don't. You go to a Chinese church in North York, it's all Chinese, but you might not see the Hmong community that's just down the road. Then maybe they're in a different church. And so last time I was there speaking for the Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada, we were in a Tamil church. And so you see the shift, But the church is not as caught up in two ways. One is in the percentage, but the second is that in the church is still ethnically enclaved in a way that society is slightly less enclaved, slightly less balkanized, where they're sort of broken in. So the church still, we were talking about this a little bit at lunch, is that there's still a Korean church, there's still a Polish church, and we'll need those, and we'll thank God for those, but we're actually at a slower pace than the society as a whole to be more multicultural and still monocultural, but we're making progress. So we rejoice with you that and share. I wanted you to get that Bible. I mean, you could exegete Revelation 7. I felt it coming. Tongue, tribe, and nation, bring it on. Go back to Acts 2. Don't forget there. But I'm sorry, we're at Trinity. Forget there. But I'm with you.
So and all I would add is that that's one of the problems with the word missional is a lot of the people who have sort of championed the missional word have been white and kind of exclusively white. But, you know, going back whether to Leslie Newbegin or how it got spread into the academy or how a lot of the conferences that were using the missional, you had to be, you know, 29 with a mohawk and an earring and hip, and that was what missional meant. But it was mostly white. And so I think you're right. We've just been launching an emphasis in mission and Western context track in the mission and evangelism department. And right at the center of that, from the beginning, I've been talking with Peter Cha, with TIU.
He calls you out as you're leaving.
As you're leaving, buddy. Great to see you, man. Rude. Love you. Love you, too.
Yeah, I really enjoyed that last point, didn't you?
I love you, too, friend. So, but talking from the beginning about making what's happening in urban environments, ethnic contexts, at some of these missional conferences, you know, one of my Latina friends said, if I see another white young hipster on this stage, you know, telling me they're so missional and taking the gospel to all these cities, I'm just going to lose it. And I think that's some of the kind of context that we need to understand. Mission is that kind of diverse, diaspora, immigrant, multi-ethnic, powerfully.
Thankfully, there's no hipsters on this stage.
Not even today, close. Today.
Let me refer close, you to, if you'll Google, first generation immigrant study, we have the largest study ever done, 30 languages, and we studied the ethnicity, language spoken at home, country of origin, receptivity, church planting and evangelism efficacy in 30 different languages. And so it's a lifelong research project that we think really helps add to that conversation.
All right.
Yeah, my name's Jonathan. I just graduated in the spring and found myself plopped down into church planting in Willow Creek's backyard. So that's an exciting adventure right now.
You will crush them like a bug.
You said that, not me. I realized that somebody on stage wrote the handbook, Missional Church Planting, and it's up for revision. So what I'm wondering is if you could show your cards a little bit and tell us how your research and what you presented to us is going to influence your study and what we should be thinking about as church planters.
Wow, that's a gift. Thank you for that. And let me encourage you on the beard. Keep it going. It'll grow in. Did you just don't give up. Give it some time. So what he's referring to is I wrote a book called Planting Missional Churches 10 years ago. We just updated it. I brought in a partner this time. His name is Daniel Im. Daniel is a Korean-Canadian, and so he had been involved in church planting missions and pastoring in Korea, Montreal, and Edmonton. And so we are now co-authors of the book, comes out in a few months. And a couple of things. We tried to update statistics, kind of get a better picture of the reality, where we were. We actually took out a couple of bad stats. You know, I just had this long speech about bad stats. I wasn't as passionate about bad stats as I am now 10 years ago, because I had a PhD and some research work between the two, and so I took out a couple of bad stats. Part of what we tried to do is, there's been a shift in church planning, and it's a substantive one in many ways. When I planted my first church, it was 1988 in the inner city of Buffalo, New York, planted a multicultural church among the urban poor. We didn't use methods. We just knocked on doors and told people about Jesus. There wasn't anything fancy you could do. It just, we were multicultural because those are the people who were left who couldn't get jobs outside of the city, and that's who we were. So, but when I went to my next church in Erie, Pennsylvania, man, we got a lot of great methods. I listened to people like Bob Logan, who I love, and Rick Warren, who's a friend, and so I learned to plant churches, and I think that shaped a generation of church planters from the 90s to maybe the early part of the new millennium. And what's happened is that's still the predominant way that churches are planted, but it's not the overwhelmingly predominant way. And so as church planning has changed. And church planning is a change. Missiology is always a changing enterprise. All church planning books are missiological adaptations to the context where you find yourselves. So if I wrote a book for church planting among the Pokot in Africa, you'd call that missiology. If I wrote a book on church planting for North America, we call that church planting. But it's the same thing. So we've done now a research project, first time ever, where we've done research on in the US, Canada, and Australia. And we've asked the same questions in all three nations and two continents. We're trying to do it in the UK as well. And so now we have comparisons. So we brought in some new data, some updated information, spent a lot more time talking about missional and incarnational approaches. There's actually into the 2010 version, I'm sorry, the 10-year-old version, which would be the 2006 version, but now is updated with new information, new voices, new ideas. And so that comes out in the next few weeks. I actually don't know when, to be perfectly honest, because it's a relaunch of a book. So, but thank you. That's kind of a softball question. I appreciate that.
That was awesome.
Right. Next question.
Thanks for sharing about the trends and some of the strategies about reaching the unchurched. I was just wondering if is there still a place for evangelism tools like programs like the Christianity Explore, Christianity Explain Alpha, and also even the big rallies like Billy Graham kind of. Is there still a place for that with the trend?
Let me answer and you finish. Yes, I think that we did a study. Matter of fact, I just got an email a few minutes ago that. About a study we did, and the Religion and Newswriters Association wants me to talk about it at a panel. And so we asked the question, what percentage of people in America, this is a US survey, wonder, if I were to die today, do I know for sure I'd go to heaven when I die? That's kind of the standard evangelical pickup line since the mid-70s. What do you think? What percentage of Americans do you think wonder every day, if I were to die today, would I go to heaven? What percent do you think would say, yes, I wonder it every day? Just shout out a number.
Two.
Two, zero. Yeah. Okay, good. 20%. That's what I said. I was stunned. I'm thinking, were we surveying Army troops before they were about to deploy? But 20%. So what happens is and I shared this data, and you know, John Sorensen, who leads Evangelism Explosion, was intrigued by this. Now, my point was, when I wrote the article, was 43% of people say they wonder every day, how can they find more meaning and purpose? So I'm thinking we want to hit on meaning and purpose, but Sorensen says, he runs EE, look, this is one out of five people are wondering every day. And so and they also have other resources. EE is, sometimes I think we're in an age where we like to mock evangelism resources more than use them. I think that's a really bad place to be. But so I think there's place for that. I think, however, that the trend is moving more towards from the large group. So if we will, I think Finney and Graham are bookends of the mass evangelism movement. There's still, I mean, Greg Laurie, you know, others, there's people still doing this. But I mean, 30 years ago, if you were a Wesleyan or a Pentecostal, you had a spring and a fall revival. You don't do that anymore. Probably most of your churches here had a spring and a fall revival. You don't do that anymore. So mass evangelism has declined. Confrontational evangelism has declined. Now, part of my concern is those have declined, and not a whole lot of other people have said, well, let's do it differently. Let's do it. So in other words, we just got angsty, filled with angst towards our methods, and then didn't do anything else. So I do think that Christianity Explored and Alpha, and my hope, you mentioned Billy Graham. So my hope, I mean, they're still doing crusades. I think Franklin's doing these state prayer meetings at the moment. But they're still doing festivals, and Luis Palau's still doing festivals. But I think what my hope with Billy Graham did, what Alpha does, and what Christianity Explored do are all the same thing, or for that matter, what Keller does in Reason for God curriculum, is you have a small group-like conversation about spiritual matters in a safe place, somebody's home. So if you're familiar with my hope campaign was Billy Graham's, you watch Billy Graham's message on a videotape and you talk about it and there's some questions. Very similar to watching Nikki Gumbel with Alpha, which is what, is it 13 million now? They just passed 13 million people have gone through Alpha. Christianity Explored, which is kind of more, I don't know, British Reformed Evangelical rather than Alpha, which is more charismatic. You know, the Holy Spirit Weekend freaks out a lot of non-charismatics. But I'm thankful for having people come to Christ in Alpha and Christianity Explored, my hope. So I think, and tell me if you think I'm wrong, I think what you're going to find is that the small community conversation that leads to evangelism is going to grow substantially. We're going to continue to see a decline of mass evangelism, though it's still going to be, all these things are still used in some place, still decline in confrontational, but it's going to be small group and perhaps some of these intentional, missional, blessed kind of approaches will grow. What do you think?
I think that's right. one of the things I like to think about is, as worldviews shift or culture shifts, sort of worldviews layer on top of each other. It's not as if one worldview dies and doesn't exist anymore, and now this whole new culture has emerged. They actually permeate each other, lay on top of each other, evolve from each other, which means that older methods work with some people still. And I'm actually really careful. My style isn't confrontational. I don't like that. For me, it feels like I want to do unto others what I would want done unto me. And when people evangelize me that way, and that's happened, I don't respond well. So I don't personally embrace it. And then I'm also concerned about the fallout, right? But I'm careful about that. So I think all the methods can work. Second, I think sometimes what we need is somebody to reinvent it for the culture. I watched York Moore on InterVarsity Evangelist. Everybody told him, Billy Graham, that's done, you know, campus-wide evangelistic campaigns are done. Just put that to bed. And then York came along, an African-American, and said, I'm going to put together evangelism and sex slave trafficking and have a huge campaign on campuses and across all of New York City, and we're going to talk about sex slave trafficking and live that out, but we're also going to preach the gospel as the spiritual part of the solution. And thousands of people have come to those campaigns. And so often it's a, how ought it to look? Then the third thing is, I just completely agree with that. Those small group approaches are the ones that are growing the fastest.
I think we have time for one more question.
So you really need to make this good.
Okay. When you show the stats, the non-denominational people are increasing, the number of those people. So is there any connection between those stats and increasing number of missional church members? Because missional church movement is based on the creating the community and the using the blast, right? So I wonder how much connection is there between that.
Yeah, I'm not sure, because I think a lot of people get caught up in a trend. Just because this is something, I mean, trends are things because people want to do them. They want to be a part of them. And so sometimes, I mean, you and I like that. I mean, that's what I write on, that's what I'm passionate about. And so we tend to say this is the trend we're passionate about. I actually, where I wrote about that chart I used in an article in the Washington Post, there was an author who wrote recently that she sort of has left evangelicalism. She'd keep saying that she was leaving evangelicalism, then she came back, leaving evangelicalism, came back. And then this time for real, she's leaving evangelicalism and she joined the Episcopal Church, or went to an Episcopal Church. And so all the news reporters were all over this story, and they're like, well, is this a big trend? Is this a big trend? And so I wrote for the Washington Post, and I called Kirk Hathaway, who's the head of research for the Episcopal Church, who's a brilliant, probably the best church researcher in America today, a brilliant guy. And I said, in 2013, how many new Episcopalians were confirmed as adults into the Episcopal Church? And he told me it was 10,013, I think is what it was. The numbers in the Post article. And then I called a pastor friend of mine, and I said, how many new people started attending your church in 2013? And so I wrote the headline of the article. I didn't put the names in there for the person who wrote the book, but I put the names in there for the church. And I said, in 2013, 10,013 or something like that, maybe 12, I forget the exact number, but it was around 10,000 adults were confirmed into the Episcopal Church, the whole Episcopal Church, the whole United States. In that same year, about 10,000 new people started attending New Spring Church in Anderson, South Carolina. And my point was that, and that's, of course, Pat Perry Noble's the pastor, and I use that as an example, not that they're even apples to oranges because comparison, but they sort of show that there's just a whole lot of people right now moving from smaller traditional churches, who I think in many ways would be more relationally connected, into large churches that they have to work towards that. However, you know, Scott Thoma and Warren Bird's research, Warren Bird wrote his PhD dissertation on this, and it's a brilliant PhD dissertation, Rice University on, it's called The Application of Free Rider Theory to Megachurch Attendance and Involvement, is that actually in large churches, depending on large church, they actually have a higher level of involvement than sometimes in smaller churches. So the reason I'm answering your question in a kind of a circuitous route is I think there's a whole lot of people who are going from churches that were more likely to be missional to churches that are more entertainment oriented. I think there's a whole lot of people going to large churches becoming more missional who weren't involved and engaged in their other church. So it's a lot of just the movement really depends upon the church, the emphasis, and its focus. And I think the answer is very difficult to say that this trend is moving people towards mission or away from mission, because I think there are other factors. I think a larger, the church Dr. Ucker and I both preached at, I preach at once a month down at Christ Fellowship in Miami. I mean, they're deeply involved in their community. They run 10,000 people, but they're deeply involved in their community, serving at a level that you won't see hardly any churches doing. And I preach to, you know, a little country church once in a while that is too, and sometimes I preach at a country church that isn't. So I don't think I can answer your question in the correlative way that you're asking it, but let me say this. I think we're in a time and a season, I'll close with this. I think we're in a time and a season that we know, and I stood before the staff of Christ Fellowship recently, and I said, listen, we are the inheritors of a trend. People are not coming to our church because we're awesome, though it might be a great church. People are coming to our church because people all across North America are coming to larger churches. We are an inheritor of a trend that we did not create, and we have to be stewards of that and help these people move from sitting in rows to sitting in circles to provoking one another to love and good deeds and being on mission. So I think we're an inheritor of that trend. But at the same time, the church I pastor in Tennessee, it's a smaller church, and it's hundreds, not thousands. And for us, we're not an inheritor of that trend. We have a church in town. You said you're planting near Willow Creek. You know, we got a church in town that runs 6,000, 7,000. Okay, that's not us. So, but still, we have this obligation, to come back to what I just lectured on in Rick's class, to provoke one another to love and good deeds. That's from the writer of Hebrews. To help people join Jesus on mission, John 20:21, he said, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. So what I want is I want large churches and small churches all to join Jesus on his mission. I believe God's going to use all kinds. He's used the mega church in Korea. He's using the house church in China. Let's hold our models loosely and our mission firmly. And let's ultimately see God's people respond to God's call. Say as Isaiah did, here I am, Lord, send me. Small, large, traditional, charismatic, non-charismatic, reformed, Arminian. I just think that right now we need to return to the mission to see people showing and sharing the love of Jesus in the midst of a broken and hurting world. Thanks for the opportunity to share.
And all God's people said,
amen. Woo! That's right. Thank you so much for being here, being a part of our colloquium, and thank you all for attending. And how about I'll just close our time in a word of prayer, asking God to bless us as we go. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what we've heard today, what we've been challenged in terms of thinking about the realities of our own North American context, especially. May you help us to continue to think about these things and to think about what is the mission. And we would hold our models loosely and the mission firmly. And that as we go from here to wherever we are going, to our churches, back to our homes, into our communities, help us to continue to think about this, how we can continue to be engaged in redemptive relationships, how we can show and demonstrate gospel fluency as we're sharing the gospel with those around us. So continue to use the words that have challenged us today in our lives as we go from here. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming. Thank you so much.